So take any polynomial from Ft. Now if E is a vector bundle on X, I'll come to what X is. Define f of E to be direct sum I from 0 to n. Oh, I forgot to tell you. So AI is a non-negative integers. If E is over X is a vector bundle, define f of E to be direct sum I from 0 to n E tensor to the power I direct sum to this. So you get a vector bundle. E is called finite. If there exist F and G distinct, not is equal to G, says that F of E is isomorphic to G of E. So now I'll recall a theorem of Nori from his thesis. Let X be a projective, I'll explain, projective variety. Projective variety means you have projective space, you have some subspace defined by some algebraic equation. So that's thing that is called a projective variety. So any kind of analog of compact algebraic varieties are like projective varieties. That's an example to keep in mind. X is a projective variety, then E is finite. Finite I have defined, there are two distinct polynomial, f and g, says that f of g is isomorphic.
Do they exist or there cannot exist such distinct?
If there exist distinct f and g, then f is finite if and only if there exist a finite eta Galois cover pi from y to x says that pi upper star of E is trivial, is the trivial bundle. So pulling back by a finite Galois cover, you can make trivial if and only if it is finite. Finite means there are two distinct polynomials f and g such that f of E is isomorphic to g of E. So now let us try to explain this finiteness condition. No, it's a projective variety. So it's an algebraic situation. It is not a topological.
Yeah.
It's not a topological. Algebraic variety. Yeah. So now, I'll try to explain the term finiteness. So before that, a vector bundle V is called decomposable if V is equal to A direction B with rank of A and rank of B positive. That means you can write it as a, if it is called decomposable, if you can write it as a direct sum in a non-trivial way. So you don't put 0 here, it, otherwise everything becomes decomposable. Yeah, demand that both are positive there. And E is, B is called indecomposable. Now you can guess then indecomposable if it is not decomposable. Now suppose you have a vector bundle E. You can of course try to keep on decomposing it. If it is not indecomposable, you can break it into smaller rank. And if they are not decomposable, then you keep breaking into smaller and smaller rank. Since the rank is a finite number, you started with a vector bundle finite rank. This process of breaking up it has to stop at some point because of finiteness. So at the end, you end up into a direct sum of indecomposable bundles. But the famous theorem of Attia says as follows. Here I am. Let X be a projective variety over an algebraically closed field. You don't need to worry about it. Projective variety over algebraic variable. Let X be either a projective variety of algebraically closed field or a compact complex manifold. So there are two different setup, completely different. One is projective variety or algebraic, another compact complex manifold. Let assume that X is either a projective variety or algebraically closed field or a complex manifold. If E if you write it as direct sum of indecomposable bundles VI, I from 1 to M, and also you write as another way as direct sum of indecomposable bundles J from 1 to N Wj. So you can write, suppose you write, first I said that any vector bundle can be written as a direct sum of indecomposables. Suppose you write it in two different ways. Suppose with Vi Wj are indecomposable. Then his theorem asserts M is equal to N and there exists a permutation sigma of 1 to M such that Vi is same as isomorphic to W sigma I. So up to permutations they remain same. To understand the theorem, let me explain when it is not true. Let us take in the sinfinity category, take X to be the sphere in R2. So S is the embedded sphere, this x square plus y square plus z square is equal to 1, the sphere. Now take the trivial bundle, R3, that while it is embedded, the trivial bundle, so it can, when you restrict to this S, you can decompose this of course in the following way. You can take the R3 can be tangent bundle to the point of the sphere and normal to the sphere, right? Take any point of the sphere, you have the tangent bundle and the normal bundle. They together span R3. So you can write S2 cos R3, the trivial bundle on S2, as tangent bundle of S2, direct sum of the trivial bundle of rank 1. So all are indecomposable, but you see there are three, number of terms is 3, and here it is a direct sum of 3 trivial bundles of rank 1. And here it is tangent bundle. Tangent bundle is indecomposable. So Attia's theorem is not valid for S2. So it's a highly non-trivial theorem. Okay. So now, why I'm saying this? I'm trying to explain. Remember, we are trying to understand the word finite here. So. So in view of this theorem, it makes sense to say some bundle indecomposable component. So this Vi are called the indecomposable components of E. So Attia's theorem says there are specially finitely many well-defined indecomposable components of the bundle E, V, and you can direct sum of. Indecomposable component doesn't depend on the choice of decomposition. Okay. Now you start with the bundle E. It has indecomposable components, finitely many. Now you take E square tensor power, all tensor powers, each of them will have finitely many indecomposable components. But if you take the union of those indecomposable components for each, for all EI, then that is expected to be a, it will be an infinite set, because you are taking infinite union of finitely many sets. Right, each one of finitely many indecomposable components, but I am taking infinitely all the powers of EI. Indecomposable component of EI is in general has nothing to do with the indecomposable components of E, right? Because it is once one is a direct sum and another is a tensor product. So now to understand, now I'll recall a theorem of Nori. This is valid in a very vast general context. E is finite. In the same context, is finite if and only if there exist finitely many bundles F1, F2, Fn, finitely many bundles such that any tensor power of E can be written as I said n, right? F1, F2, Fn, yeah. Direct sum. So, no, I was sorry. I have e to the power j. No, I just give it here, it is j. For a, I, j are non-negative integers. So, there are finitely many models such that any tensor power of E can be written as a combination of these. So basically this, so equivalent formulation is that from this theorem it follows immediately that E is finite if and only if you take the union of the indecomposable component. So that total connection is also finite. So that's the origin of the name. So this finite collection, infinite collection of this finite sets is again finite. So, but this theorem is a categorical statement theorem. No, sorry, which one? Why did I write Norris theorem? So this is in vast generality. It is not only for projective variety. It is for compact complex manifold, for example. It at least in this generality it holds. Projective varieties or compact complex manifold. More a categorical step. Okay. So now, let me understand the other statement in the Norris theorem, that there exists a finite, if and only if there exists a finite cover, says that this. To understand this, that is covered by, trivialized by et al. Cover. Let us take the field to be characteristic 0, or let us take complex numbers. Now, suppose the pullback is trivial. Now, trivial bundle has a trivial connection. Now, automorphisms of a trivial bundle are given by maps from the base to GLNC, and this is a compact, like a compact complex manifold or a projective variety. So, there is any map from Y to GLNC has to be a constant map. So, that means any two trivializations of the bundle of a bundle differ by a global single automorphism element of GLNC. That means any automorphism of the bundle preserves the trivial connection. So, trivial connection on the trivializable bundle doesn't depend on the choice of trivialization. Therefore, this connection descends to a connection on this trivial connection. But this is connection difference, but not the trivialization descends. So you have a connection with a, it will have non-trivial monodromy. If this connection is flat, so it will be descend as a flat connection. Curvature is 0, so it's a local condition. It will still be a local flat condition connection, but it will have finite monodromy. It will have a monodromy, but monodromy will be finite because after pulling back, it becomes trivial. Monodromy becomes trivial. So if what I finally saying that if the bundle is pullback is trivial, then trivializable, then take any trivialization, take the connection given by the trivialization, it doesn't depend on the choice of the trivialization, this connection descends, the trivial connection is flat, so descended connection is flat. Flat connection is monodromy. This monodromy is finite because after you, when you pull it back, it becomes trivial. So it has finite. So if pullback is trivial, then it has a flat connection with finite monodromy. Conversely, suppose a bundle has a flat connection with finite monodromy. That means it is given by some represent homomorphism to GLNC with finite image. So finite image means I can take the kernel. Kernel of row. Since it is finite, this will give me a finite Galois cover. Now, when you restrict the representation of what is the fundamental group of that new manifold, this will be finite Galois cover y to x. And what is the finite fundamental group of this manifold is by definition is the image here. And that by homomorphism it goes to the trivial group. So that means when you pull back this bundle, it becomes a its monodromy becomes trivial, so it becomes flat connection with a trivial monodromy. That means the bundle becomes trivial. So what I have finally said is that there exists an et al. Cover such that a bundle has the property that there is et al. Cover such that pull back to the ethyl alcohol history, we have this condition is equivalent to the condition that the bundle has a flat connection with finite monodromic group. Okay. Now, let us say a few words about the proof of Norrie. For the proof, he develops what is now known as the Tanakian category theory. Actually, Savedra Rivan, another person, more or less simultaneously also developed it for some other reason. But anyway, what it amounts to showing that to prove the theorem, he needs to show the following thing. There exist F1, F2, finitely many bundles. There exist finitely many bundles F1, F2, Sn such that. You know, before I say that, his theorem says that if and only if X is finite if and only if it has a it has ethyl trivial, that by pullback to a covering is can be made trivial. Now, one way is fairly straightforward, namely if it is trivial and by pullback by ethyl cover, then it is finite. That is, it is you can easily understand that, because Haller earlier said that it is correspond to a representation to a GLNC by with image is finite, and finite group has this property because finite group has finitely many representations. So when you write all the polynomial representations of a standard representation, there will be some polynomial equations. So from that it is follows, it is using that is straightforward, that if it is ethyl trivial, it is you can trivialize by an ethyl cover, then it is finite. Non-trivial part is the other way around. Suppose you start with a finite bundle, you want to show that it is ethyl trivial. So you start with a finite bundle. Norrie has to show the following to prove the theorem, that there exist finitely many bundles F1, F2, Fn such that one, any e to the power tensor to the power I tensor E dual tensor to the power j can be written as a combination of this F1, F2, Fn. That means is equal to L from 1 to n F I direct sum C I J L, C I J L are non-negative integers. So any E tensor I tensor E star tensor J can be written as a combination of this finitely many bundle. Then another take any combination of this these bundles. So direct sum L from 1 to n F L direct sum say A L, and you take another homomorphism from another bundle of this P from 1 to n I can write L F L direct sum instead of A L instead of B L. You take two bundles which are combinations of this F1, F2, Fn, but with copies of direct sum, many copies. And a homomorphism, he has to show that take any homomorphism, homomorphism of bundles can need not be kernel and co-kernel need not be a bundle, right? It can vanish somewhere, homomorphism or etc. So he has to show that kernel and co-kernels are bundles and they are also of this type. Kernel, they call it F, kernel F and co-kernel F are bundles, and are of this type. Namely, direct sum of FIs with many, many copies. So these are very strong conditions. But once you prove these things, then from general categorical follows that it is ethyl trivial. You can trivialize by finite ethyl cover. So he has given a finitely finite bundle. He has to prove that there are fine F1, F2, Fn with these properties. Now, his method of proof is that is kind of one major step is induction. You cut by hyperplanes. If the variety is there, you take a hyperplane and then prove that it is enough to prove this for hyperplane and then keep cutting. So, then finally, you land up in a curve, one dimensional. I am not saying that it becomes trivial, the proof theorem becomes trivial for curves, it does not become trivial, but it becomes substantially simpler when you dimension of the x is 1. You have come down by curve by this Lipschitz kind of idea by cutting by hyperplanes. So, I have been always been for a long time been interested in the theorem for compact complex manifolds, because this theorem statement makes sense, right? Finite, if and only if it admits a flat connection is finite monodromy or ethal trivial, because the definition makes sense in the for compact complex manifolds. So, but the Norris method does not work because we cannot in general compact complex manifold does not have any complex submanifold. So, you cannot cut the dimension, that is the main reason. So in with Holla and Schumacher. In 1999, we proved the theorem for scalar manifold, x scalar, x compact scalar, a vector E on x is finite if and only if E admits a flat connection with finite monodromy. The idea was since the algebraic method did not work, but on the other hand there are theorems, theory developed by Corlett, Simpson, Donaldson and Hinchin, which gives you some sufficient condition, some strong condition under which a scalar on a scalar manifold, you have a bundle on a scalar manifold admits a flat connection. Basically, it is related to the what you call the it has to let me not get into that. There are criteria for sufficient condition for the existence of flat connection. So, our method was using finiteness, we try to prove that they satisfy this finiteness condition. So, it admits a flat connection, but their theorem says that is flat connection has some canonical properties. Then we try to prove that it is the monodromy is finite. So, it became a game of more kind of differential geometric purely. So, yeah, finally, we could prove it. That was Holla Schumacher. Then in 2016 with Mamsi Pingali, we proved this for Astano Keller, same. When x is Astano Keller. So, Keller means a Hermitian structure has the corresponding one form omega is closed. D omega is 0 is the Kellerness condition, Astano Keller is d omega to the power delta minus 2 is 0, where delta is the dimension, complex dimension of x. This is the Keller condition, this is Astano Keller condition, this is weaker condition, and this was done by refining this approach, trying to improve that what the Donaldson Ulenbek Yao, this correspondent. And anyway, along this line it was proved. But it was, after proving, it was very clear that this is the kind of hit the bound, limit. This method doesn't extend anymore. So so what I want to say is that last few minutes. Then it was realized that this notice this criteria, this algebraic criteria, that there exists finitely many f1, f2, fn such that any ei tensor e star to the power ej can be written as combination of them, and there are homomorphisms such that any homomorphism between two such bundles, kernel and co-kernel, has this property. That can be proved in the complex, compact complex case. So I will just give a, since I don't have time, 5 minutes, I will just prove one lemma in that direction. The first lemma, which will give you an idea how in the finiteness, well, under the assumption of finiteness, in the compact complex manifold case, you can hope to deduce this Norris, the bundles that are required with the Norris criteria. Okay, let me say, suppose let X be X. Compact complex manifold E over X a finite bundle. Finite bundle means there are two polynomials f and g, distinct polynomials, as f of E is isomorphic to g of E. Let S be a holomorphic section which is not identically zero, which is not identically zero. Suppose you have take a section, suppose it exists, suppose you have a section which is not identically zero, then claim, then S X is not equal to zero for all X at length. That means if it is doesn't vanish at some point, it cannot vanish at any point. See, it is a section of a holomorphic bundle is like a locally is like a function with multivariable function with image is a multivariable. So it can happen that vanishes somewhere and doesn't vanish somewhere. In holomorphic section, it can happen, but this is a very strong statement that if it doesn't vanish at some point, it cannot vanish anywhere. I'll give this proof. This is the beginning of the strategy of the proof, but I'll just give you this lemma. So suppose S of X naught at a point is zero. It vanishes. So it vanishes at some order. Then consider S tensor to the power I, which is a section of H X e to the power I. It vanishes at X naught of order at least I, right? Because S vanishes at X naught, so S to the power I, which is a section of E tensor to the power I, should vanish at a right. So now, by the finiteness theorem, you can, there are finitely many bundles F1, F2, Fn. Let us recall the Norris criteria of finiteness. There are finitely many bundles such that any e to the power I, you can write it as direct sum j from 1 to n f j a I j, where a i j's are non-negative integers. There are finitely many bundles f1, f2, fn independent of I, such that any e to the power I can be written as combination of this. Now, s to the power I is a section of this. So, s to the power I is a section of this. So, since it is a direct sum, section of a direct sum, the section decomposes, right? As sections of each of the, it becomes, because I have a direct sum of bundles and a section. So, I can just project to each factor and then I can get a section of each factor. And the original section is obtained by taking the direct sum of these different components. Now, since this section is not identically 0, since it is, S is not identically 0, S to the power is not identically 0, in some component has to be non-zero. S to the power I should have some non-zero component. In some component has to be non-zero. Now, s to the power I vanishes at x naught of order to the power I, at least I. So, all when you decompose it as a direct sum of sections by projecting it to different factors, each of them has to vanish at of order at least I, right? Because you are writing as a given section by decomposition, you are writing a direct sum. So, if it is vanishes at somewhere of some order, each component has to be because it is a direct sum, each component has to vanish of order at least I. So, what is happening? Given any I, some fj has a section which vanishes, which is not identically 0, but vanishes of the order I. Now, this is now we are finished. Sorry, I am given a holomorphic bundle and a point, look at order of the vanishing of its sections. On a compact complex manifold, a holomorphic bundle section, holomorphic section is a finite dimensional vector space. When you put an order vanishing, you put at some linear conditions. So, after putting some certain stretch, it has to be 0 because start with the finite dimensional space. So, given a holomorphic vector bundle and a point, the order list of the, if you list all the orders of the sections vanishing at that point is a finite set. And there are finitely many bundles, f1 and f2. So, there will be finitely many orders where it can vanish. But here it has to vanish of arbitrarily large order. I is arbitrarily large order. So, it's a contradiction. So, x0 cannot be 0. That was the contradiction. So, S section cannot vanish anywhere. So, this is the beginning point. Then you can develop and this and I'll stop here.
Yeah.
If I only.
Yeah. If we turn around and ask the following question, we fix the compact complex manifold. You look at all bundles which admit such finite fact connection with finite monotony.
Yeah.
And at the corresponding tensor category out of that. What kind of stuff will it give the profinite completion of the fundamental group or something like that? If I look at the all.
Yeah. Yeah, it will be a Tanakian category and it will correspond to the category profinite completion of the fundamental group. Yes, yeah. That's right. That's right.